On a scale of 1 to 10, I'd say today's video ranks at 11. I'm most excited to talk about the Mohs Scale, mineralogy's nifty little ladder of hardness. We've been using the system of measurement for over 200 years, but it never hurts to brush up on the basics. First, let's learn the difference between hard and tough, because even though those terms are pretty much synonymous out there on the streets, they mean different things when we're talking about gemstones. The Mohs Scale measures hardness, which is a gem or mineral's ability to resist scratching. Toughness describes a mineral's ability to resist chipping and breakage. Example time, diamond is among the hardest natural substances on Earth and at the tippy top of the Mohs scale, but it's not the toughest. Diamond's crystal structure is octahedral, which means it has four planes of cleavage. Those planes are relatively weak compared to the rest of the gem, and minerals have a tendency to break along those planes. So jadeite jade, with its interlocking crystals or grains, is actually tougher than diamond, but only a 6.5 to a 7 on the Mohs scale. The Mohs scale, devised by German mineralogist Friedrich Mohs in 1812, judges a gem or mineral's hardness on a scale between 1 and 10. This scale is convenient, but it isn't perfect. Mohs could only measure minerals readily available at the time, and the values between the numbers are pretty much arbitrary. Fluorite, a 4 on the scale, is about 25% harder than calcite, which is judged as a 3. But diamond is more than 4 times harder than the next lowest gem on the scale, corundum. What gems fall where on the Mohs? Starting at 1 and heading to 10, we've got talc, gypsum, calcite, fluorite, apatite, feldspar, quartz, topaz, corundum, and diamond. If you've got a big exam coming up in Geology 101 and need a handy mnemonic device to remember this, try 12 gigantic cows fought against 50 quick turtles. Crazy days. Or today's gemologists can forget about flinging quarters towards Charles Dickens. Please note, I didn't say these mnemonic devices would make a lot of sense, I just said they'd be handy. As you'd expect, the further you move up the scale, the more difficult it is to scratch the mineral. Talc and gypsum, rated 1 and 2, can easily be scratched with just your fingernail. That won't work on calcite at number 3, but you can use a penny. By the way, Mohs wasn't the first person to observe that minerals can be scratched, not by a long shot. Ancient Greek philosopher Theophrastus wrote about gemstones around 300 BC and noted how hard they are relative to one another. A few hundred years later, famed Roman Pliny the Elder used Theophrastus' work as a trusted source when he wrote Natural History. You can learn more about Pliny and ancient Rome's take on gemstones right here. Knowing all about gemstones' physical properties is one of the most important skills a lapidary can have, next to a steady hand, of course. This understanding is what helps the lapidary decide how and where stones can be cut and shaped. Gem-quality sphalerite, for example, isn't very hard, just 3.5 to 4 on the Mohs scale, and it's very brittle. Its perfect cleavage in 6 directions makes it difficult to cut and polish, but sphalerite's dispersion is even higher than diamond, so expertly cut sphalerite, usually colored yellow to reddish orange, is truly beautiful. And just like how you can't make an omelet without breaking a few eggs, you can't test minerals on the Mohs scale without potentially damaging them. It's a lot of fun for field testing minerals, but I would not drag a nail across a new pair of earrings if I were you. Have you ever flung quarters towards Charles Dickens? Ever had a crazy day where you saw cows and turtles at battle? Tell us about it in the comments. And while you're there, you know what to do. Like and subscribe, y'all. For more information on the topics we discussed today, check out the links below. Thanks for watching, guys.